world knows the best way to get things done is to form a team.
Susan, you know who Drew Brees is?
I know who Drew Brees is. Of course I know who Drew Brees is.
Go Saints!
Go Saints! Thank you, Dan.
Let me tell you something about Drew Brees.
What do you know about Drew Brees?
Well, last year, Drew Brees earned $20 million.
$20 million.
Wow.
That's a lot of money. I wish he was a member of our church.
Anytime. Yes, that is a lot of money. There's something else that Drew and all of us need to remember.
What's that?
He couldn't make it alone. He needed his team to do it.
You're right. It is a team effort. And Cooper needs his Vacation Bible School team together to bring it VBS game on. We need it to win Vacation Bible School in 2018. The VBS team needs all of us working, praying together to make it a success.
Tell us the dates again. It's important information for next Sunday.
Okay. Next Sunday, we're going to have registration. It's going to be in the Family Life Center. We're going to provide lunch for you, cotton candy, snow cones. We're going to register you for Vacation Bible School. If you can't attend, we understand. You'll still have the opportunity to register every night at VBS. But this is going to be our kickoff, and you're going to be able to play games and just see what it's going to be all about. We're so excited. So many people working together to make this a success. So that begins following our morning worship next Sunday in the Family Life Center. And then beginning that Wednesday on the 25th, we begin on a Wednesday evening at 6 o'clock, we will start our VBS. We'll go Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday night, and then we'll end on Sunday morning. Classes for all ages. We begin, if it's a child and a nursery age child, that's fine. If you will attend our adult VBS, you will not include your child in our nursery, but the classes are from 4 years old to adult, so come join us. Oh. Yes, yes.
Will you please pray for Vacation Bible School for the day for all of them? Father, we love you.
Yeah. Lord, that didn't be here on Monday. Father, we just thank you for our Sunday school hour that we have on Christmas time. Lord, we just pray that you can help us to understand what giving to you is all about. Father, we just thank you now for the tithe offering that you've given us. We pray that we will use it, Lord, according to what you want to do, Father. We just pray that you'll bless the giver and the giver as we go through this service. And in this shape of control of our worship time, Lord, give the pastor and be the brother over as they bring the word of God out and praise it too. Forgive us and guide us now, for in your name we pray. Amen.
Humble himself and carry the cross. Anxiety or peace. Proverbs 12, verse 25 says, anxiety in the heart of man causes depression. Be a good, but a good word makes it glad.
Functional atheism. And what that means
know, you are worrying and having anxiety in such a way, it is, you're living as though the Almighty, you're living as though the All-Sovereign, you're living as though our Heavenly Father is not in control. Functional atheism. You're living as if God does not exist, your Heavenly Father. You see, anxiety is linked to numerous physical problems. Let me read some of these to you, just a few of them. Mood swings, irritability. By the way, don't look at each other when I'm reading this. Anger. Rapid heartbeat, chest pain, exhaustion, nervous twitching, decreased concentration, decreased memory, nausea, shortness of breath, hair loss, weight gain, or weight loss. Panic, indecisiveness, insomnia, self-medicating, drug and alcohol, high blood pressure, comfort food, and reckless driving. That's just some of the things that anxiety is linked to physically, and not only that, anxiety is a joy killer. It's a joy killer. The joy of the Lord is our strength. It affects you, and it affects everybody around you, whether you know it or not. It is a joy killer. It's you become so self-absorbed in your worries that it is an alarm clock daily that you carry around, a heavy burden that you're carrying around, and not only is it making you a dysfunctional person, it is affecting those all around you. Nothing pleases you. You're dissatisfied. There is no contentment at all in your life. There's always something wrong, no matter what. So it affects you. It's a joy killer. Also, anxiety robs you of peace. Of peace. Joy and peace, these are not physical problems. Joy and peace, folks, that's spiritual. Joy and peace, those are, and if anxiety is robbing you of these two things and affecting these two things in your life, the bottom line is that's a spiritual issue. What do we do? What do we do? Do we go get a massage? Go on a vacation? Go see a doctor. Live a life of denial. Escape. What do we do? Just yesterday, my wife actually went fishing with me yesterday for about an hour and a half. And if you're a fisherman, you'll laugh at that. We were eating in a little restaurant by the lake. And while we were waiting on our food, an old retiree came in. I could tell he was, and another retiree was sitting at a table, and these were older gentlemen, and they were talking, and one of them wanted to order, and the waitress was very busy. There was people in there. And this retiree, that in the conversation he was having with this other retiree, he has lived he said, I used to fish every day. You know what this man did? He became so anxious that he walked behind the counter and tells the cook what he wants on his hamburger. This man had a life of escapism. He escaped and went fishing every day. Every day, and yet he was so uncontent, so dissatisfied in life, no peace at all, that he could not wait to tell Rachel what he wanted, what kind of food. What I'm getting at is, all these things, massages, the perfect vacation, guess what? You got to come back. You got to come back and be in the real world again. Or you can literally live a life of denial, go fish every day, go play golf every day, or whatever you think is going to bring peace in your life. But guess what? It will not do it. Because it is a spiritual problem to be robbed of joy and peace. Even if you come to church, every time the doors are open and you worry and have anxiety in such a way, it can affect you. And guess what? It can affect the entire church. Because all you're doing is pointing out every little detail that is wrong. Guess what? We're not perfect. We're not. So it becomes a spiritual problem. So what can we do? Because all these other things, they're good in their places. A vacation is wonderful. Going fishing is great. Everyone say that again today. All that is good stuff, but it does not fix the spiritual problem of peace and joy. Let's read the latter part of this proverb. By the way, I've told you before and I'll tell you today. The book of Proverbs is a book of wisdom, and a natural lost man or woman can read Proverbs and get practical wisdom, because it is wisdom. But a born-again believer, there's more to God's wisdom and then just practical wisdom. There's a spiritual teaching here. And it says, but a good word makes it glad. So what's the good word? What's the good word? You see, we need God's word to know God's peace. God's word to know God's peace. So turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. And this is what Jesus says about worrying and anxiety. It begins in verse 25, but we're just going to look at verse 31 through 34. Jesus says this, therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own thing. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. So Jesus said, don't be like the pagans, at that time they were called Gentiles. Don't worry about all this, but trust God. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. That's what our Sunday school lesson was about, was it not? That's what it's all about. Are you going to trust God or not? Where's your trust at? Now the commentary, a good explanation 4. Philippians chapter 4. Turn there. Philippians chapter 4. Jesus said, don't worry about, you know, your clothes and what you're going to eat or wear. Look, God takes care of the bird. And, you know, the grass of the field. But seek first the kingdom of God. So how do we do this? How do we do that? How do we work and give this problem of anxiety and worry, this spiritual problem? What can we do? How do we seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness? Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. The Apostle Paul says, be anxious for nothing. Everyone say for nothing. Don't worry about anything. Now some things, the good worry, the good concern keeps us on our toes. But the Bible tells us, be anxious, don't worry for nothing. Everyone say nothing. That means, you know what that means in the Greek? It means nothing. What it means? So be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer. This is the seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness for the child of God. It says, in everything, everyone say everything.
Everything.
Be anxious for what?
Nothing.
But in everything by prayer, in supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. So be anxious for nothing. Don't worry about anything, but in everything, go to the Lord in prayer. Go to the Lord in prayer in everything. Someone would say, well, I only bother with God or talk to God about things. You ever heard that one? I have. Let me ask you this question, in all sincerity. What is big to God? Do you have an answer for that? What is actually big to God? Actually, our problems, are the big things to us, they're not big to God. And He tells us, His children, as born-again believers, His Word, and God in the flesh Himself says, don't worry, but do what? Talk to me. Talk to me. In everything. If you want a life of joy and peace, talk to me, he said, about everything. The word prayer, it's an attitude of worship. It's a prayer. If you really want a life of escapism, you can go to a place anytime, any day, where you can literally escape all the care and worries and problems of this life. You, as a child of God, in the name of Jesus, our high priest, can enter in the holiest place where problems and troubles cannot follow you there. Pray about everything. Worship Him. I know there's times in my life where I start getting off thinking things and worrying about things, and then I go to an attitude of worship and talking to God, and I may play the same song over and over and over again on my phone or in my truck, a song of worship. You see, the troubles and problems can't follow me there. They can follow you out. They'll follow you, ladies, wherever you, whatever you do, they will follow you. But they cannot follow you in the throne room of God. So pray about everything. Worship. In supplication, this means being honest with God, sharing with God. It is a fervent prayer about our needs. And supplication, again, it's being honest with God, and it's an attitude of thanksgiving. It goes back to our Sunday school lesson. Aren't you thankful for all God has given you? And I'm so thankful that I have access to the throne room of God in Jesus Christ. Aren't you? How grateful we are and how thankful we are. And it says, make your request be made known to God. Now, do you think God doesn't already know? He does. He's sovereign God. He knows everything. He knows our hearts. He knows what we're thinking. He knows everything. So why do we make our request be made known to God? Folks, I cannot explain everything, but I do know somehow the free will of man and the choices of man and the sovereignty of God, they're both true. But somehow God limits himself to our prayers. If you want true revival, then pray. If you want peace and joy, then you must pray. And yet God is sovereign. So if God says, make your request be made known to him, then what do you think we ought to do? That's what we should do. Amen. We have a choice to have peace or have anxiety. You have a choice to have joy in your life or have anxiety. You choose. You choose. But it's an attitude of thanksgiving, and he promises us in verse 7, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. Now this peace of God, or, you know, peace in the scriptures is peace with God in salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ. Then there's going to be a peace when the Prince of Peace returns and he rules and reigns. But this peace here in scripture has to do with totally yielding ourselves to the Holy Spirit of God, is totally trusting God, is totally in worship and in prayer with God. Being obedient. Trusting him. And it surpasses all human rationality. It goes way past human reasoning. It goes past all understanding, but if you have ever experienced it, you know what it means. It says this. You ready? And we don't be anxious for nothing, don't worry about anything, but we go to the Lord in prayer. This peace says, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. By the way, he's writing this to a good church, the church at Philippi. And he promised them and us that God, this peace, stands guard. It guards our hearts and guards our minds. When we go to the Lord in prayer. And it's through Christ Jesus. There's only one access. There's only one way. And that's through Christ. Amen. He's the way, the good to the light. And if you don't know Jesus, you can't have this. You can pretend. You can have a feel good. You can know all the practical wisdom you want to know. But if you want to deal with the spiritual problem, you got to go through Christ. For salvation and for this peace that guards our hearts and minds, you got to go through Jesus. Because he's the only access to the place where the troubles and problems cannot follow you. And that's the throne room of God. He's the only way. Will you go to him? Will you follow him? Will you trust the Lord Jesus Christ? Let's pray. Lord, we're in a time, as you know, Lord, we're in a time of peace, of assurance of your word. And we know, as we leave this place, and maybe even in this place, there's going to be trouble. There's going to be problems, things we got to face when we leave this place. But we know that we can have peace and joy through it and in this because of you, Jesus. God, I pray strength for my brothers and sisters this week. I pray, Lord, that we'll have joy and peace in such a way as we deal with problems that we will glorify you. Lord, I pray for those who need to follow you in faith. I pray for those who need to have a public confession of faith this morning to tell the church that they belong to you and that they will be obedient through believer baptism. I pray, Lord, that they will surrender their all, lay down whatever is besetting them, and follow you. And I ask this, Lord, in the name of Jesus, in the powerful name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand. And as you stand, if you need to trust Jesus, I'll be here to help you need prayer. If you need to make him love you, confess him before men, so he'll confess you before the Father. Won't you come now? Just come right now.
Thank you.
somebody, and there's also flyers in the foyer. Because I can't pay that before. I don't pay for it. Now I'm at the back door, back in here. Thank you, Miss Tim. Let's close in prayer this morning. Brother Ed O'Dell, would you close us in prayer?